Last time we revisited the topic of solutions, particularly aqueous solutions, and we reviewed some concepts of concentration like molarity and percent mass, and also practiced with some that might not be as familiar, at least in this course, like molality, parts per million, parts per billion, different ways in which we represent the concentration of a solution. You have a lab activity, that's all a dry lab, so worksheet. And I'm sorry for the delay in posting the answers. Because of the mix-up that happened with my Chem 1B class, and I had to kind of like re-record that lecture and stuff, everything got pushed back, and I'm running way behind on my both classes. So apologize for that, but hopefully we can stay focused and I can get back on board soon. So let's go ahead and revisit our topic here. We are talking about solutions. And today's topic is mainly the process of forming a solution and what are some of the factors that affect whether you can form a solution or not with a given set of substances, all right? Let's start out by looking at the process of forming a solution. The process is called solvation, not salvation, because this is not theology here. It's when a solute dissolves, the solvent molecules surround the solute molecules to maximize intermolecular attraction. So this is where we narrow down the definition of a solution in order to involve intermolecular attraction forces. So that means that not every homogeneous mixture is in and of itself a solution if there are none of these intermolecular forces. We've already seen before in a previous chapter what happens when I dissolve a crystal of sodium chloride in water. As we know, crystalline solids are packed in a form of very, very well-ordered crystalline structure. But because of the excess of the water molecules, what happens is, as you can see there on the right, the water molecules essentially begin to surround the ions of the sodium chloride. Now, notice the orientation. If you see the water molecule with the red atom being the oxygen, the white ones being the hydrogens, remember that water is a dipole. Notice that the partially negative end of the dipole of water is the one that's pointing towards the sodium ions, which are blue in this picture, whereas the partially positive end of the dipoles are pointing towards the negatively charged chloride ions. And essentially, the solvation process involves solvent molecules forming these cages around the particles of the solute, all right? Now, let's talk a little bit about energy and thermodynamics of forming a solution. When you look at what happens in the formation of a solution, you find different scenarios. For example, some compounds like sodium hydroxide, when you dissolve them in water, a lot of heat is released. The container gets really hot. But with other compounds, like for example, ammonium nitrate, when you dissolve it in water, actually, heat is absorbed from the surroundings. It's an endothermic process. The container gets really cold. And the question is, why is this? So let's propose a very simple model to explain the thermodynamics of forming a solution, all right? Let's say that as the solution forms, there are three types of interactions that we have to deal with. You have solvent-solvent interaction. You have solute-solute interaction. And then you have the newly formed solvent-solute interactions. So if you look at this diagram here, you can see, for example, step one involves pulling apart some of the solvent molecules away from each other so that they can interact with the solute. Step two on the top right is the solute, which in this case I'm putting in as a crystalline solid. Those interactions have to be broken up to allow the solute to be able to mix with the solvent. And then in step three, this is the step at which solvent and solute interactions take place so that the solvent might surround the solute particles and accomplish the making of the solution. Notice that I've put a delta H for each one of these steps, for the solvent, for the solute, and for the solution. So essentially, since we are breaking down this into three steps, regardless of whether this is the way it actually happens, remember we talked about Hess's law earlier on, the total heat involved in forming the solution will be the sum of the delta H's of each one of these three steps. Now, what we need to do is let's look at these interactions in a little more detail, all right? And let's look at the interplay between the three sets of interactions. First of all, to make a solution, you're gonna have to first of all overcome all the attractions between solute particles. Now remember, whenever you pull particles apart from each other that were in a stable arrangement that maximized their interactions, that process requires input of energy. So therefore, this process is expected to be endothermic. The second thing is, for the solvent molecules, same thing. You have to overcome some attractions between solvent molecules. This process should also be endothermic. Now remember, in many solutions, in most solutions, the solvent is in a vast excess over the solute. So that means that, you know, technically not all the solvent molecules have to be pulled apart from each other, only those that are going to be involved in forming the cages or the you know, the solvation little surrounding of the solute particles. So that's what I'm saying here, overcome some attractions between solvent molecules. Now the third step here is you have to form new attractions between solute particles and solvent molecules. Once more, since this is a process in favor of an attraction force, it should proceed with a net decrease in energy, in other words, a more stable arrangement, and so delta H of mixing should be exothermic. So when we calculate the overall heat for making a solution, it's all going to depend on the relative amounts or the relative sizes of the enthalpy for each one of these three processes. The enthalpy change for the solute, the enthalpy change for the solvent, the enthalpy change for the actual making of the solution. So we'll come back and visit this. Just keep in mind this idea that forming interactions is typically exothermic, breaking up interactions is typically endothermic. Now, in terms of what those attraction forces are, those interaction forces are, we're going to consider four types of them. But of course, these are non-covalent, because these are not formations of any kind of covalent bonds. So three of these we've already discussed before, and the fourth one we mentioned in the previous chapter, but we didn't get to go into it. Okay, on the left, you have London dispersion forces. Remember, these are the ones that are formed when substances achieve temporary partial dipoles due to simple shifting distortion of the electron clouds of the molecules. We discussed them in the previous chapter in terms of pure substances, but notice that in a solution, that type of interaction can also happen. We see it here between two nonpolar compounds. We also have dipole-dipole interactions, and these occur only between substances that are polar. Once more, in the previous chapter, we only consider pure substances, but here we're considering a solvent interacting with a solute, and here we're showing an interaction between two polar substances, acetone and chloroform. Of course, there's the very strong hydrogen bond, which is what is responsible for many of the properties of liquids such as water. Its high boiling point, its high surface tension, its polarity influences that. And of course, if you have a solute that is capable of hydrogen bonding, then it can also hydrogen bond with water. The fourth type of interaction is the one we actually showed a few moments ago when we're looking at the formation of a sodium chloride solution. This is where the solvent is a dipole, it's polar, and the solute is ionic. So this is what we call an ion dipole force. Notice that in this case, the water molecules are dipoles. They're not completely charged, they're partially charged, but the sodium ion itself is completely charged. It has lost electrons, right? So this is a different kind of interaction we hadn't looked at before, because really we only see it when you are making a solution, all right? All right, so let's look a little bit more at these ion-dipole interactions that we've been mentioning. Of course, we said before the process of the solvent surrounding the particles of solid, we call it solvation. But because many solutions have water as a solvent, we have a special name for it. We call it hydration. And so when you dissolve ionic compounds in water, we can say they become hydrated. Each ion is surrounded by water molecules. In this particular example, we're looking at a solution of potassium fluoride, and you can see how the water molecules surround the ions. Again, the partially negative end of the water dipole is facing towards the positively charged potassium ions. Whereas in the case of the fluoride ions, which are negatively charged, it is the partially positive end of the water dipoles. There are experiments that you can do where you can actually calculate what is the ratio of water molecules for every ion. Actually, you can actually calculate those kind of things. It is a little beyond the scope of our studies here, but just be aware that that happens. As a matter of fact, many ionic compounds, when they form solutions in water, they actually form these very specific complexes between the ion, particularly the metal cation, and a specific number of water molecules. And many of those solutions have specific, you know, interesting colors like blue or pink or purple or greenish, and it has to do with that interaction of the metal cations with the water dipoles. Now, you can actually measure the heat that is processed during the solution process. In other words, the heat that's transacted there. We can call it the heat of solution. Now remember that essentially, if we propose this model, that what we're doing is we are separating the solute particles and the solvent particles, and then we are releasing energy as the new solute-solvent interactions are formed, for example, in this case, the ion dipole. The difference between the energy required for the separation of the solute and solvent particles and the energy release upon the formation of the new interactions, that is essentially what the heat of solution is, all right? Now, let's say that the solvation process, or in the case of water, the hydration process, let's say that it releases more energy than what was needed to separate the pure solvent and solvent particles. I'm sorry, solvent and solute particles is a typo in there, right? In other words, the return of energy is greater than the investment that had to be paid up front to separate the solvent molecules and the solute particles from each other. Well, in that case, since there's more energy released, there is a surplus. That means the net heat of solution is negative. The overall solution process is going to be exothermic. So you're going to, if you can put a thermometer in there and do it in a calorimeter, you will see the temperature of the solution will increase because of the release of heat. Now, if on the other hand, the process of solvation releases less energy than what was needed to separate the pure solvent and solute particles, then you're gonna have a net deficit. In other words, you had to spend more energy pulling these particles apart than what you got by forming the new interactions. And that means that the heat of solution is gonna be positive. Energy is gonna have to be borrowed from the surroundings to make up the deficit. And so the overall dissolving process is gonna be endothermic. Now, in previous lessons, in previous topics, we've talked about how, you know, in nature, mostly things tend in the favor of processes that release energy. In other words, that bring you to a more stable lower energy state, right? So it makes sense that if the solution process is exothermic, that makes sense. It means that you are going to a lower energy state. But how do you explain an endothermic dissolving process? How do you explain that in this case, you're actually going to a higher energy state, in other words, a less stable state, and you're having to borrow energy to make it happen? And we know they do happen because, as I mentioned earlier, many substances like ammonium nitrate, they dissolve perfectly well in water, but it's an endothermic process. Well, it's time for us to talk about another actor on the stage of chemistry. In our first week, we introduced the main character, which is matter, its properties and its transformations. And as we have gone through the journey of chemistry, we've seen on the stage emerging this major character called energy. And we know that every transformation that matter undergoes, there's an energy transaction that accompanies it somewhere at some point. Well, it's time to introduce a third character here on the stage. Kind of a little late in the play, but nevertheless, very important. This is a property called entropy. Now, let me explain to you a little bit, just for a few moments, give you a kind of like a tourist approach to what entropy is. You've probably heard the word before, and you may have heard it associated with chaos and disorder. But it's actually a little, it's not that dramatic, actually. Now, remember, number one, like we said, physical systems typically tend toward lower potential energy. That's more stable. But it, like I said, the formation of a solution doesn't always lower the potential energy. Sometimes it increases it. There is a net increase in energy. It's endothermic. Now, let's consider two gases, neon and argon. These are noble, ideal gases. I'm going to put them in a container that's separated by a wall or a separator there. And I'm going to open that barrier, that gateway between the two chambers. What do I observe? Well, I observe that they spontaneously mix. Now remember, these are ideal gases. There are no intermolecular attractive forces, or in this case, interatomic, because these are atomic gases. I know if there's any, it's negligible. In other words, they mix spontaneously, but there is no net difference in energy here, right? Now, what we say is that the reason they mix, the reason why gases diffuse from a place of higher to lower concentration, is a totally random process that is called entropy. The energy of the system is not lowered because of an direct energy transaction in terms of enthalpy, but because of the release of entropy. Let me give you an example. Okay, let's say that you go and you buy yourself a nice new deck of playing cards, right? Now, you take off the shrink wrap, you open it, you pull out the deck of cards, you spread it out, and how are they organized? Right, they're organized by suits and in order, right? So if you pull them out of the box and spread them out on the table like a croupier would do, here you go. Well, not Dr. D.A. Dr. D.A. is kind of clumsy. And these cards, when they come out of the box, they're very slippery. So in Dr. D.A.'s case, what you're going to get is something that looks more like this. Yes, I'll probably spill them all over the floor. So I'm going to have to pick them up. Let me ask you this. What is the likelihood that when I scoop up these cards and put them on the table, I'll get this right back without any intervention, just by sheer randomly picking up the cards and throwing them on the table? Very unlikely, right? Very unlikely. It is more likely that what I'm going to see is essentially more of that. Maybe a little shuffling, but mostly this. Why is that? Well, think about it. If you allow the cards to essentially mix randomly, there are 52 cards in a deck. All right? To get this kind of arrangement, it requires, for example, that the first card be specifically, let's say, for example, in this case, the Ace of Spades. There's a 1 in 52 chances that the first card that I pull out will be that one. Then for the next one, there's another 1 in 51 chances now that the next one will be the one that I want, and so forth. In other words, if I allow these cards to mix purely by random chance, there are 52 factorial possible ways that these cards could combine. And out of those 52 factorial ways, this one that I'm showing here is only one out of those. So by sheer probability, any process that is allowed to proceed randomly is most likely going to generate a state that is not highly ordered. And that's what entropy is. Entropy is a measure of the number of random arrangements available to a system in a given state. That's what entropy is. It's a purely statistical function. All right. Now, we talked about energy earlier on. So when you mix substances to form a solution, what you are giving is you're giving the energy of the system a chance to disperse itself, to distribute itself amongst all the particles in this new solution system. Entropy is a measure of the many ways in which that energy can be dispersed throughout the system. Now, by the same reason that my playing cards would rather spread out spontaneously into all kinds of different combinations instead of the one that required the effort to put them into the box in the first place, energy also will have a spontaneous drive to spread out over as large a volume as it is allowed. So when we looked at the mixing of the gases, neon and argon, what happened was that by each gas expanding to fill the container, instead of staying in one corner of the container, it spreads out the energy of the system out and therefore increases the entropy. Consider when I dissolve a crystal of salt. Let's look at the picture here on the left. That crystal is a very highly ordered structure. As we've talked about in the previous chapter, crystals have a very well-ordered structure where every particle occupies a specific predictable position. The water in the solvent is not as highly organized, but they do have a certain measure of organization because water as a liquid has, you know, limited degrees of freedom of movement. When I put the salt in the water, all those ions are now freely dispersed randomly throughout the whole water sample that's in there. In other words, the sodium chloride went from a highly ordered, low entropy, in other words, limited distribution arrangement, into a high entropy, in other words, randomly distributed with more possibilities. So, in other words, just like in most systems, a decreasing of the energy is favorable, in the case of making solutions, increasing the entropy, in other words, creating more disorder, more random distributions of the particles, also is favorable towards making a solution. All right. So when a solution forms, we have to take into account not only are we dealing with energy transactions in terms of the interactions between particles, we are also dealing with entropy, with the redistribution of particles from a maybe more ordered to a less ordered state. And what happens is that, let's say, a reaction, let's not call it a reaction because not every solution process is a reaction. The process of solution can be endothermic. In other words, it might require an input of energy, but the entropy increase of the process is sufficient to outweigh, to overcome that otherwise unfavorable energy change and allow the solution to form. Now, why are some substances insoluble, particularly in water? Remember back in chapter 4, we studied the solubility rules and we found that some ionic compounds do not dissolve in water. Why is that? Well, usually the reason is that if you calculate the heat of solution, the process is just too endothermic. There's too much energy required, and as a result, the entropy factor, although it is favorable, it's not enough. It cannot overcome the large difference in energy between the pure substances and the solution. All right? And that is a thermodynamic approach to explaining why some substances are soluble and some are not. Substances are soluble if A, they proceed into solution with an exothermic process, and or if their entropy change is sufficient to overcome what could be potentially a non-favorable energy transaction. Substances that are insoluble typically have a positive or endothermic heat of solution, and their entropy change is not sufficient to overcome that. All right. Now, looking at ionic compounds, we can go back here and discuss the steps in the process. In the case of an ionic compound dissolving in water, as I mentioned earlier, the ratio of water molecules to solute particles is humongous. In other words, a very small proportion of the water molecules actually have to be, you know, opened up to make room for the solute particles, you know, in the grand scheme of things. And so sometimes we just consider it like a two-step process. As you can see here on the left, we're going to plot the energy as we take a crystal of potassium fluoride and dissolve it in water. Like we've done in other thermochemical processes, let's invent a path. Let's say that the way we're going to do this is we're going to take all of the ions in the crystal, ions in the crystal lattice, and we're going to pull them all apart from each other. So essentially, we're going to convert the ions that are in the crystal structure into their gas form of those ions. That, by definition, is the lattice energy of the compound, right? We studied this in a previous chapter, and we learned how to use a Born-Haber cycle, where we can calculate what is the lattice energy for a particular ionic compound. Let's say in the case of potassium fluoride, we find that the lattice energy is 821 kilojoules per mole. Now, in our second step, we're going to take those gas ions and we're going to hydrate them. We're going to dissolve them in water. We're going to allow water to come in and surround those ions. Again, remember, the process itself might not happen this way. In other words, we don't see, when we dissolve a salt in water, we don't see the ions becoming gases and then going back in the water. This is a path that we're proposing because what we're interested in is what is the initial and what is the final state. The final state is essentially potassium and fluoride ions AQ, in other words, in aqueous solution. Notice that in this case, the heat that was required to separate all the ions in the crystal lattice is very large. The energy released by the hydration of those ions is negative 819 kilojoules per mole, which means that there's a net heat of solution here of plus 2 kilojoules per mole. Not a huge difference, by the way. So essentially what we're saying is that if we invent this path for the solution of an ionic compound in water, the overall heat of solution consists of two components, the heat of hydration and the lattice energy for that particular compound. All right. So like we did before, let's compare these. Now, remember, when we say the heat of hydration, in a manner of speaking, we're including in there the process in which water molecules became separated from each other as they formed the new ion-dipole interactions with these potassium and fluoride ions. So we're kind of like combining the solvent-solvent with the solvent-solute interactions into this so-called delta H of hydration, okay? Just be aware of that. Now, like we did before, let's look at this as a business transaction. Hydration energy is always negative. Remember, you are forming new interactions in favor of a attraction between dipoles and ions. So we are essentially going to a lower energy. It's exothermic. Lattice energy is positive. It requires an energy input in order for you to separate those ions, right? Now let's say that I go and I do this process in a calorimeter and I find out that the solution process is endothermic. In other words, delta H of solution is positive. What does that tell me about the relative values of the heat of hydration or the hydration energy and the lattice energy? Well, it tells me that in terms of absolute values, the hydration energy is smaller than the lattice energy. So that means that when you add up the negative delta H of hydration plus the positive delta H lattice, since the delta H lattice has a greater absolute value, that makes that equation positive, and therefore delta H of solution is positive. The solution process is endothermic. Okay, everybody understand that? I'm just kind of talking a lot, but it's actually just math. Let's say that when I did the process in a calorimeter, I find that the process is exothermic. It releases heat. So that means that the energy that it costs to separate the ions is less than the energy released from hydration. In other words, delta H of hydration has a greater absolute value than delta H lattice. So when I go to the equation there on the top, that means that the negative delta H of hydration, you add the positive delta H lattice, still leaves you with a negative value for delta H of solution. In other words, it is exothermic. All right. So you can see how all these things that we studied before, where we invent these paths and we compare the delta H of each path and we can predict outcomes, it works in this case also. So just like when we studied lattice energies, we had to draw a cycle of reactions of known enthalpies so that we could calculate what the lattice energy was. In the same way, because we have values of lattice energies, and because we can measure the heat of solution in a calorimeter for many substances, we can use this equation to calculate what is delta H of hydration of an ionic compound. So let me go through this little practice exercise here, which might not have made it to your handout. So I'm sorry about that. If it didn't, please take some time to look at this or copy it or take a screenshot. Here are two compounds, calcium chloride and calcium iodide. There you have the lattice energy for each one. And then you have the heat of solution calculated in a calorimeter. Notice that they're both exothermic processes. Both of them release energy when they dissolve. All right. So the question they ask here is, which of those two is more attracted to water, calcium chloride or calcium iodide? Okay, so our model says that the heat of solution should have been the heat of hydration plus the heat of the lattice energy. In the table above, we have the lattice energy is given, and they have the heat of solution that's given also. So if I take delta H of solution and I subtract the lattice energy, that's going to give me a value for delta H of hydration. So what we're going to find out is what is the hydration energy as each one of these compounds dissolves in water. Okay, so simple math. So for calcium chloride, it's going to be delta H of solution minus 46 minus delta H lattice, which is 2247. So that's going to be minus 2293 kilojoules per mole. All right, let me have you guys do calcium iodide. I'll give you a few seconds to work that out in your calculator. See what you get. Okay, so minus 2,163. Now the question was, which of the two is more attracted to water? So what I need to do is I need to use the numbers that I got to answer a question that seems to be more qualitative. So think about it. If a substance is more attracted to water than another one, that means that it's going to make a stronger or more stable interaction, right? That means that it's going to go to a lower energy value, and therefore the energy change, the delta H, should be bigger. So which of these two compounds proceeds with the larger delta H of hydration? Calcium chloride, right? It's roughly about 130 kilojoules per mole more stable than the calcium iodide. It has a stronger interaction, so we would say that the chloride ions, in this case, are more attracted to water. Why do I say chloride? Well, because both of these have calcium in them. So once they dissociate, I mean, the hydration of the calcium should be the same in both cases, right? But the hydration of the anion is different. One of these is chloride ions. The other one is iodide ion. Now, I want you to think a little bit. Does this make sense? Why would it make sense that the chloride ion would have a stronger interaction with the water dipole than the iodide ion? What is the big difference between them? Not the charge, because they're both minus one. That's right, the size. Remember in the periodic table we said that if elements are in the same group, as you go lower on the periodic table, those valence electrons are being held in shells that are farther away from the nucleus, and therefore those atoms are bigger. Since these are both ions, that means that the electron clouds of the iodide ion are more expanded. It gives it a bigger radius than the chloride ion. And we said that for any kind of charge interaction, although in this case it's not really a full charge, it's the interaction between a charged particle, the ion, and the dipole of water. Remember that as the distance between them increases, the force decreases. Since chloride is the smaller ion, we would expect, therefore, that the charge density is greater, it's more concentrated, it's smaller. So the water molecules can pack in a little closer to that charge, and that explains why it would have a stronger attraction to water. All right? All right, so let's go ahead and make a stop here. Let me know if there are any questions.